second review of our findings, etc. As we mentioned in the report, we are interested in discovering the effect of parapsychologists in order to understand the main job or the main task of the psychologist. Because answering the question about the different parapsychologists will enable us to understand and answer the question of what do psychologists do. And as we said also before, we can discriminate between two types of psychologists. The first one, the neurophysic psychologist, and the second one is applied psychologist. And we need to define the first type as the neuropsychologist try to discover the basic laws and the principles of psychological and mental phenomena. And we said the second two aims of psychology, description and understanding, are the main aims of the view or basic psychologists. They try to describe, they try to name or classify the psychological phenomena without asking the question of why. And also they try to understand and explain the psychological phenomena by discovering their causes, by discovering the factors, variables, mechanisms that cause this phenomena and maintain them. Today, the different subtypes of neuro-basic psychologists, and we will cover some, about six subtypes. The first one is experimental psychologist, second one, physiological psychologist. The third one is talking about the psychologist who is interested in animal psychology, and the fourth one, developmental psychologist. And also we will cover some about social psychologists and the psychologist who is interested in abnormal psychology. And you have to take into account that if we are trying to define any subtype of psychologist, in that way, you can define the discipline itself. For example, if I give you a definition, the definition of experimental psychologist, you have to understand that we can use the same sentence in defining experimental psychology as a discipline. And also, if you know some about physiological psychologists, that way you can also understand the meaning of physiological psychology as a discipline, and so forth. Now, we have to move and define the first one, experimental psychologists. Most of functions or psychological insertion method. Or the scientific insertion method is a basic strategy that's scared to be designed to ensure that reliable facts can be established by the independent investigators or by the same investigator. And instead, we have three subtypes of that scientific method. One of them, the experimental research. And by definition, we can say now the experimental research method could be used by the experimental psychologist, but also it could be used by other psychologists, such as clinical psychologists, educational, social, child psychologists, and so on. But one characteristics of the experimental psychologist that he depends mainly on the experimental research method. Now, to sum, we covered three main points. The first one, what about the definition of experimental psychologist? And the second point, what are the main topics studied in the experimental lab? And the third one, the relationship between experimental research method or experimental approach and the experimental self-approach. Now we move to the second subtype of the basic psychology. The second subtype is physiological psychology. The first two points define physiological psychology as a discipline and the physiological psychologist as a profession. What about the physiological psychology? Physiological psychology is the study of the physiological basis of behavior. You remember, we define psychology, and while we were talking about the subject matter of psychology, we said before that the subject matter of psychology involves three aspects. The first one, overt behavior, including the motor activities, verbal reports, so verbal communication, and non-verbal communication. And the second aspect is overt behavior, including all functions, psychological functions that are derived and internal, and they are indirectly observed, such as feelings, emotions, motivation, intelligence, creativity, and so on. And the third aspect is physiological changes or physiological factors or physiological variables or biological variables or factors or mechanisms that correlate with overt and covert behavior. We are not interested in physiological factors as they are because we are not physiologists, we are psychologists. We are interested in the relationship. Our main focus is the relationship between physiological factors and psychological factors, physiological functions and psychological functions. So we can define physiological psychology as the study of physiological basis of behavior. In physiological psychology, we are trying to discover the relationship between physiological factors and psychological factors, between physiological or biological functions and psychological functions, between behavior and the physiology of the body. And I mean by behavior, either we are talking about overt behavior or covert behavior. What about the definition of physiological psychologist? We can define physiological psychologist as a person who investigates the body structure and functions that seem most directly correlated with the behavior, that most directly related to the behavior. So we are not interested in these body structures and functions as they are, but we are interested in the relationship between these structures, these functions, these biological structures, these biological functions, and psychological functions or and behavior. Either we are talking about overt or covert behavior. And of course, we can use these two definitions interchangeably. So I can say that physiological psychologist, he is the person interest is in the brain itself, but I am interested in the relationship between the brain and the behavior, robot or robot behavior. I'm not interested in hormone itself, but I am interested in any sort of hormones. But I am interested in the relationship between some sort of hormones and behavior. For example, the relationship between adrenaline and aggressive behavior, for example. And now, what about the main points? The main points that could be studied in physiological psychology. From psychophysiological point of view, we can study all psychological functions, such as perception, motivation, emotion, learning, memory, cognition, mental disorder, psychological impairments, and so on. We can study all functions, but from psychophysiological point of view. What do you mean by psychophysiological point of view? Psychophysiological point of view means that we are trying to discover the physiological basis of this function. We are trying to relate between bodily structures and functions and these psychological functions. Now, the fourth point that about the factors that may, physical factors that may affect our behaviors. You should know that any factors that could affect the nervous system in turn will affect overcoming overcoming. Any factor will affect, will influence the nervous system in turn, or by definition, will affect the overcoming overcoming. For example, metabolism, hormones, disease, drug injection, diet, heredity, all these factors are expected to affect the nervous system, and by definition, and in turn, will affect the over and over the behavior. The last point in this area about the physiological psychologist is that, like the experimental psychology, in experimental psychology, we have said the experimental psychological lab, and also in physiological psychology, we have psychophysiological lab, and also we depend on lab research and the quantitative data in physiological psychology, as we do in psychological experimental psychology. Now, to sum, we covered six main points about physiological psychology. Number one, what about the definition of physiological psychology? Number two, what about the definition of physiological psychologists? Number three, what about the main topics that could be studied in the physiological psychology from psychophysiological point of view? Number four, what about the main factors, main physical factors that affect the nervous system? And number five, what is the relationship between these factors and overt and covert behavior? And we said, because these factors affect the nervous system in turn, this is a short effect also over and over the behaviors. And number six, what about the physiological lab and the quantitative data? So that we already a physiological psychology we depend on them. Now, we will move to the third file. The column five is developmental psychologist. Before explaining the definition of developmental psychologist, we have first did some about the psychologist who is interested in animal psychology. If you remember, while we were talking about the definition of psychology, one of these definitions was it is the scientific study of overt and covert behaviors in humans and animals. So one of our subjects, one of our participants in our psychological research are animals. And And he stated that the cognitive numbers is very, very, very fast. Number two, the boy of number two, what about the age of each stage? Number three, what about the main characteristics of each one? So you should be acquainted with 3 points about each of these 4 stages. Number one, what about their names and sequence or order? What about the age interval or age of each stage? And what about the main characteristics of each one? Let us start with the first stage, sensory motor stage. The first stage, sensory motor stage, it is from birth to age 2. And it is characterized by 2 main things. Number one, 2 main issues. Number one, a children experience the world through movements and senses. It is the only way to explore the world, to understand the world, that the child uses his senses. The second characteristic is that children in this stage are extremely egocentric. I mean, they are characterized by egocentrism, meaning they cannot perceive the world from others' viewpoints. They believe that they are the center of the world or the center of the life. They cannot consider others. They are very, 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 very egocentric. What about the second stage, pre-operational stage? It is from age 2 to 7. And the main 2 characteristics, the main 3 characteristics in this stage are, number one, magical thinking predominates. I mean by magical thinking, illogics. The second point, or the second characteristic, acquisition of motor skills. This stage is characterized by motor skills development, rapid motor development. And the third characteristic, what about egocentrism? In this stage, begins very, 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 very strong, and then decreases. So we have 3 main characteristics, magical thinking predominates, acquisition of motor skills, and egocentrism begins very strong and then decreases. What about the third stage? Concrete operational stage. It is from age 7 to 12. And it is characterized by logical thinking. Children can think logically, but are very concrete. They are characterized by concrete thinking. What is the meaning of concrete thinking? Concrete thinking is the opposite of abstraction. If you depend on your sense, it is concrete thinking, but if you depend on mentality, it is abstract thinking. For example, if I am talking about this bed, it is a concrete concept because you can perceive it with yourself. But if I am talking about freedom, love, it is an abstract concept. And this is the difference between concrete and abstract. What about the last stage, formal operation? It is from age 12 onwards, and it is characterized by abstract reasoning or abstract thinking. In this stage, the children can think logically and in an abstract way. To sum, we have 4 stages, and the order of them as follows: sensory motor, pre-operational, concrete operational, and the formal operational. The first one is from pairs to age 2, the second one from 2 to 7, the third one from 7 to 12, and the last one from age 12 onwards. The first one characterized by depending on movement and senses, and children are extremely, normal psychology. but clinical psychology is a branch of applied psychology. What is the difference between abnormal psychology and the clinical psychology? Is the difference between abnormal psychology and the clinical psychology is the same difference between basic psychology and applied psychology. In basic psychology, you are trying to describe and explain psychological factors or psychological functions. And in applied, you are trying to put these residents into practice. The same is the difference between abnormal and the clinical. In abnormal psychology, you are trying to understand, you are trying to describe the abnormal behavior, the psychological disorder, psychiatric disorder, the psychological problems. But if we are going to make a diagnosis, if we are trying to treat this disorder or to prevent this disorder or make prevention, in that case, we move from abnormal psychology to clinical psychology. And don't forget that we said before, actually, no clear cut between the two kinds of psychologists, the basic and applied, and also abnormal and clinical, because many psychologists may combine between the two kinds of characteristics of what they do and the same activity, the two kinds of activities of what they do. The same in abnormal and clinical. Maybe someone, if you think he is doing the research about the abnormal behavior, in that case, he is a psychologist in the field of abnormal psychology. But if he is trying to apply these results of research in order to help the humans, what the means of helping humans, diagnose them, treat them, prevent them, in that case, he moved to applied psychology, or I mean, he moved to clinical psychology. For example, I did my master research. My master research was the neurological characteristics, neuropsychological characteristics of people who at risk for this disorder. In that case, I was working in the abnormal psychology, in the field of abnormal psychology. But if I am going now to apply the results of this research, in order to make prevention, in order to prevent these people before they develop the disorder, in that case, I will be moved from abnormal psychology to clinical psychology. Now, what is the definition of abnormal psychology, or the psychologist who is interested in abnormal psychology? He's concerned with, or this discipline is concerned with, or this profession is concerned with, discipline, if I'm talking about abnormal psychology, is if I'm talking about the professional in this area, in this abnormal psychology. He is concerned with the odd and the unusual aspects. I mean by odd, abnormal, something unusual. The odd and the unusual aspects of the behavior, the experience of overt behavior, looking towards the understanding of people that are just to understand. But if I'm going to move to predict or control, in that case, I move to applied psychology. Now I am in the clinical psychology field. That's all about the basic psychologists. Define basic psychologists, and then we cover some about subtypes